Greetings. Welcome to ZGC, Zion Gate Chapel. I am Kip Ezekiel, broadcasting to you from capital city Addis Ababa, on the side of the east, the holy mountains of Ejersagoro, where this man was born, Rastafari.
It's the chapel, power of the Trinity. Build your mind. Serve the living God and live. Take your troubles to Selassie. He's the only King of Kings.
Say it now, yeah. Conquering Lion of Judah. Triumphantly we are.
Yes, greetings. Welcome once again to Zion Gate Chapel. Today we are going to be looking at Rastafari Passover, the Resurrection and the Rain, April 21st, 1966 in Jamaica. Well, as we know, it's a common knowledge that Christ's second return will be in the flesh, although popular Western belief teaches that it's not so. They propagate that it's only the Spirit that will come and dwell within us. This is Western theology. They also ignore the literal existence of the throne of David and its prophetic fulfillment. But I say the Spirit of Exiabir is always with us, and also the throne of David. They never left us. But men and people ignore them. Now, before the Lamb's departure, he told us that he will send us another Comforter, our Messiah. This Comforter, who he is speaking of, is actually another person. Let us read John 15:26.
John 15:26. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me.
This verse is so specific and clear, but still, Western theology teaches something different. Here, the word even demonstrates that there are two entities and they are united as one. In Amharic language, this is called Tawahido, spirit and flesh in one perfect union. Therefore, the Comforter and the Spirit of Truth is one and the same. Further confirmation on Eastern theology views on the reality of the person of Christ and the throne can be found in the book of Acts 2, verse 30. We will read. It says, according to the flesh. So it is a surety, throne and person. And Hebrews 9:28 says, they that wait for him shall he appear the second time without sin and unto salvation. It says, again. This indicates another person, for it says appear. I don't know why their preaching ignored these fundamental facts. Maybe hidden agendas, more than likely. Now, one of the primary works of this Comforter is to restore the tribes of Israel. In his restoration works, it must be witnessed upon the throne of David, for that's the sign and seal which carries the authority of Israel's redemption. Now Israel is expecting a king to come and restore them to their former state, particularly an earthly king, according to their requests from God. This is found in the book of 1 Samuel 8, 4 to 7. We will read.
Then the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and come to Samuel unto Ramah, and said unto him, Behold, thou art old, and thy son walks not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, Give us a king to judge us. And Samuel prayed unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Samuel, Hearken unto the voice of the people and all that they say unto thee. For they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them.
So Israel needed someone in the flesh to represent them in place of the Holy Spirit. This meant that their faith was beginning to fade away. This now brings the necessity for a new covenant for Israel and also the world's salvation. So finally, after Israel have lost all their earthly kings, they thought that Jesus Christus was the one to fulfill that position and restore the kingdom. But firstly, he must teach them the new liberty of the new covenant to enable them to return to God on the spiritual level, or else they would remain in the same physical mentality as before, filled with rituals and sacrifices. Therefore, the teachings and demonstration of the new covenant had to be installed in their hearts and take root in their minds before the sealing of the promise, salvation, and restoration. Let us look at a few prophecies of Jesus the Christ. Matthew 26:31 and Luke 21:4. Also, we'll look at Matthew 24:21 and 34.
26:31. Then Jesus said unto them, All ye shall be offended because of me this night, for it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock shall be scattered abroad. Luke 21:24. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles, unto the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Matthew 24:21. For then shall be a great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. Matthew 24:34. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled.
All these prophecies highlight our scattering, not gathering of Israel, and alludes to a new generation. Therefore, Christ at his first incarnation definitely didn't restore the kingdom on the physical level. That will be fulfilled when Israel's rightful king appears on the scene. Let us look at Daniel chapter 7. This can justify Christ's second incarnation in his kingly character. It even gives a description of his physical appearance. Daniel 7, verse 9.
I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the ancients of days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flames, and his wheels as burning fire.
Who is the ancient of days that sits? It must be that person who has the spirit of truth. Now it says the thrones were cast down. This must be a literal casting down, as it correlates with that what prophet Ezekiel said about the final overturning. He says, in Ezekiel 21, 27 there about. I will overturn and overturn it until he whose right it is comes. So the owner has come and his kingdom is everlasting and shall not pass away or be destroyed. This part is found in Daniel 7 verse 14.
And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed.
And we should not be expecting him to be forever sitting there in the flesh. For now the restoration is sealed, and we can return to Exiabir in the spirit and allow the high priest Samuel to rest in peace. And I must inform you about the original constitution of Ethiopia. In Article 2 it states, the imperial dignity shall remain perpetually attached to the line of Kadamawi Haile Selassie, meaning whatsoever comes into the kingdom must come in through the imperial dignity and spirit of Kadamawi Haile Selassie, the Sun King, for he is the first and the last one who seal the throne. Now let us look at Christ in his kingly character at his second incarnation. We will read Joel 2 verse 11 and Revelation 19 verse 11.
11. And the Lord shall utter his voice before his army, for his camp is very great, and he is strong that executeth his words. For the day of the Lord is great and very terrible, and who can abide it? Revelation chapter 19, 11. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war.
These verses tells us clearly that the coming king will be a military leader who comes in righteousness to judge and make war, with the purpose of the restoration of Israel and also to execute righteous judgment for the poor and oppressed of the world. These are the signs and works that Israel must look for in our time on earth, the works of the king. This is prophecy, not a pie in the sky, the king and the covenant. We encourage ones to look deeply into the great coronation of the conquering Lion of Judah to clearly see the spiritual exoneration of who he really is. Now let us look at the generation that will seek him. Jeremiah 31, 28.
Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 28. And it shall come to pass that like as I watched over them, to pluck up, and to break down, and to throw down, and to destroy, and to afflict, so will I watch over them, to build, and to plant, saith the Lord.
So will I watch over them to build and to plant. This is the scattered Israel. They will need a solid foundation to stand on, as Jesse. Jeremiah 29, I'll quote, it says, who seek me will find me. So let us remember, everything has its appointed time, which has its counterpart from heaven. As we say in our daily prayer, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We will now read Ezekiel 6, 8.
Ezekiel chapter 6, verse 8. Yet will I leave a remnant, that ye may have some that shall escape the sword among the nations, when ye shall be scattered through the countries.
The nucleus of this scattered Israel was found in the island of Jamaica. Now, on the arrival of his imperial majesty, Kadamawi Haile Selassie, the Lion of Judah, a heavenly and mysterious reign came with him, and lasted from the time the plane came into view until its landing, accompanied by a sudden appearance of seven white doves that brought with them a bright sunlight by which everyone was made dry within minutes. This spiritual and physical simultaneous manifestation is the real thing. This was witnessed by the remnant who was seeking his face, and also many others were there. This prophetic and timely rain is also found in the book of Hosea, chapter 5 and 6, and is referred to as the latter rain. These verses also reiterate why God hid his face from the children of Israel. It also reveals the time and circumstances by which he will return to us. Let us read Hosea 5, 14 to 15.
Hosea chapter 5, verses 14 to 15. I will tear them and go away. I will take them away, and no one shall rescue. I will return again to my place till they acknowledge their offense. Then they will seek my face. In their affliction, they will earnestly seek me.
It will be at the tail end of our afflictions when he will rescue and restore us. And in chapter 6, it states the precise amount of days that this will occur. Let us read Hosea 6, 1 to 3, and also verse 11.
Hosea chapter 6. Come and let us return unto the Lord, for he hath torn, and he will heal us. He hath smitten, and he will bind us up. After 2 days will he revive us. In the third day he will raise us up, and we shall live in his sight. Then shall we know if we follow on to know the Lord. His going forth is prepared as the morning, and he shall come. He shall come unto us as the rain, as the latter and former rain unto the earth. Also, O Judah, he hath set an harvest for thee when I return the captives of my people.
2 days to revive us, and on the third day he will rise us up. His Majesty's visit, our Passover, was exactly 3 days, the same amount of days as the resurrection of Jesus the Christ. This is found in John 2:19 when he says that he would rise up the temple in 3 days, which we know that it's referring to his physical resurrection. And this also prefigures the April 21st 3-day visit to Jamaica. Now verse 3 confirms this mystical event by stating that he will come to us as the rain, a heavenly synchronicity that was witnessed by everyone present. This particular rain is the latter rain, meaning the second coming of Christ with the promised Holy Spirit. But this time, he comes to us in his royal and kingly character, roaring like a lion, with the blessings of literal rain. Now the former rain was the promise to the disciples at the day of Pentecost, when the Spirit came down upon them from on high. This is found in Acts chapters 1 and 2. These promises of the giving of the Holy Spirit is evidence of the power and blessings of Christ. Let us look at the footnotes of Hosea chapter 6, 1 to 3. From Life in the Spirit Study Bible. And we must not forget the time of the first Passover when the children of Israel left out of Egypt. And we know that it is in the month of April. And if we check in the Bible, in the book of Leviticus 23, 4 to 8, we will find the actual time and date when the Passover is celebrated. Let us read.
Leviticus chapter 23, verses 4 to 8. These are the feasts of the Lord, even holy convocations, which ye shall proclaim in their season. In the 14th day of the first month, at even, is the Lord's Passover. And on the 15th day of the same month is the feast of unleavened bread unto the Lord. 7 days ye must eat unleavened bread. In the first day ye shall have an holy convocation. Ye shall do no servile work therein. But ye shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord 7 days. In the seventh day and an holy convocation, ye shall do no servile work therein.
From the 14th to the 21st, the same time when His Imperial Majesty passed over the Caribbean islands of Trinidad, Haiti, and Jamaica, and it was sealed with the rain when He arrived in Jamaica. The multitude at that day of Pentecost who witnessed that mysterious event had to be there for that same purpose. The purpose of being a witness to the working of the Holy Spirit. Same as the latter rain in Jamaica, the whole multitude witnessed for themselves this mysterious rain from heaven. Very, very important. This history must be our history right about now. We can see in the media, you know, Putin, whose name is, his baptismal name is Mikhail, he now reveals all the Black Christ, the Black Madonna, and all. So our history was taken away from us. And all our elders, our parents, got brainwashed in all of that. Now the truth came out. We must keep our history. This history in Jamaica, this mysterious happening cannot be taken from us. So we give in thanks for that day. Let us now bear witness to the authority given to the elders of our faith by our John King. Firstly, he said, I have longed to see these people. He also said that Jamaicans and Ethiopians are blood brothers. This statement can be verified in the Ethiopian book titled Amistenia Gubaye. Secondly, gold medals were awarded to the elders of our faith. And what is the significance and meaning of a gold medal? It represents someone who came first or is first in place. As His Imperial Majesty said, to be first in place is to be first in merit as well. Gold medal is very important. Number one, the leader. Okay, number three. Elder Ras Alvaranga, he breaks down our way forward. Let's listen to this video clip.
Thousands of people came to the airport in that day. Emperor Haile Selassie had to call for Martin Moplana to take him from the plane steps because of the large crowd that gathered around the steps. The official spoke over a microphone. He says, call him Mortimer Plana. He came over in seconds and was right at the plane step with His Majesty.
We met him at King's House and he said to us, how long does the Rastafari movement start in Jamaica? We said to him, ever since your coronation, Your Majesty, the 2nd of November, 1930, he said to us, your work are purposeful. We must continue in our endeavor. That means we must stop the Rasta. Right? Him say, but here when Gob say now, you must centralize and organize.
The Emperor's endorsement reduced tensions and gave weight to the political demands of the movement.
The visit of Selassie confirmed Rastafari beliefs for many people. Many people were, you know, convicted in Rasta from that day.
Your works are purposeful. And what are the works that we are involved in? I think it is well known, preaching the gospel, that the Comforter has come. And what he said after that, organize and centralize. Let us listen to our elder Mortimer Planner and the approval of our faith. We'll watch this video clip and see a caption from the Feta Negas.
All right. So when the IDM sitting with Haile Selassie now, that reason ever come up amongst Haile Selassie about him being Christ, him being God, you know, how the Rasta man seen, what him think about what the Rasta man are saying.
Well, your mother say, in a water that, you know them thing where they call full stop, or comma, who am I to deny their faith? Rasta say, you're God, sir. Him say, who am I to deny their faith?
And him said that in front of Almost Ran. Who said that to him? Say Rasta same as God.
But we have it here right now with his majesty himself saying that. Who am I to deny their faith? We have it on tape here.
No, what may I say? When who look upon him and say, the Rasta them say you is God. Who
look Dr. Douglas.
Oh, Douglas said that.
Yeah.
Oh, and him turn to Douglas, you know, and say, who am I to
deny their faith?
So what Douglas said to him now?
No, nothing to say. What I want to admit.
So there is no way Kadamawi Haile Selassie could deny us our faith. He would be violating the most fundamental spiritual rights. And remember, he's the head of the church and the defender of all faiths. This law is also found in the Feta Negas, the Law of Kings, chapter 35, Coercion and Duress. I quote, to compel a man to deny his faith while he believes in it wholeheartedly is absolutely prohibited. Let me paraphrase what Elder Priest Rasbonagis said unfolded at the banquet at King's House, where Kadamawi Haile Selassie, through his divine powers, he summoned a police to go and ask Rasbonagis why he grew his hair so long. Rasbonagis sent back the answer, quoting from the book of Numbers, Leviticus, and Samuel. Then Haile Selassie said to the police, leave the Rastafarians alone, they know what they are doing. Now this police is the same police who on more than one occasion brutalized Rasbonagis and put him in jail. Mystically, by the divine grace of Kadamawi Haile Selassie, this spiritual and physical revelation unfolded in the eyes of our elder Rasbonagis and that same policeman in particular. As His Majesty says, spiritual power is the eternal guide in this life and in the life after. All of these mystical and spiritual evidences which unfolded in Jamaica is unparalleled by any event in our modern times and clears up any doubt about what we have been saying and who we have been waiting for. Now let us hear from an Ethiopian Orthodox Tawahedo church point of view on the spiritual works of Kadamawi Haile Selassie. They analyze it in this way by using John chapter 10, the Porter. Reading from the book, Know Jerusalem, by His Grace, Abuna Philippios.
Readings from the book, Know Jerusalem,
by his grace, Abuna Philippus of Jerusalem. Our people in all innocence accepted the Egyptian's father's declaration that an Ethiopian bishop cannot be ordained. But the wise and cautious leader, Makonnen, with his acute sense of justice and unbiased philosophy, broke the ice in 1921 when he had five Ethiopian bishops ordained, headed by an Egyptian archbishop. Thus, the parable of the sheep and the porter of which Jesus spoke in St. John 10 was appropriately interpreted and given a concrete shape in Ethiopia.
Now, on behalf of the Rastafari nation and priesthood, I will say that Hosea chapter 6, verses 1 to 3, was given concrete shape in Jamaica when the conquering line of Judah came with the rain and stayed for 3 days. This is the testimony of our culture, both spiritually and physically. Our eyes have seen the King in his glory. Blessed love. Hope it have been informative, and hope to see you next time in the chapel, here broadcasting from capital city, Addis Ababa. One perfect Rastafari love.
Launch your brand to the next level. Rastafari TV network and site media's powerful reach and unique niche market of roots and culture lovers reach a passionate market from around the world. Site media one-stop branding resource ensures your brand is consistent, professional, and polished across all platforms. From logos to websites, print collateral to promo videos, we've got you covered. Advertise with Rastafari TV network and site media visionaries, and let's create a project that truly shines.